Good evening and welcome to Dhamma Sukha Meditation Center again. This is this evening with Bhante Vimala Ramsey. We'll be teaching out of the Digha Nikaya this evening, number 15, the Mahanidāna Sutta, the Great Discourse on Origination.
Thus have I heard on one occasion, the Blessed One was staying among the Kurus. There was a market town called Kasa Sadama. The Venerable Ananda, excuse me, my dyslexia is playing tricks with me now. And the Venerable Ananda came to the Buddha and saluted him, sat down at one side and said, "It is wonderful, Lord. It is marvelous how profound this dependent origination is and how profound it appears. And yet it appears to me as clear as clear." Now, when he first became a monk, Ananda, when he first became a monk, he started meditating and he became a Sotapanna. And he never got the fruition. And what he's talking about now, he just had the fruition and he understood the links of dependent origination very clearly. That's why he says it's clear, it's easy. "Do not say that, Ananda. Do not say that. This dependent origination is profound and appears profound. It is through not understanding, not penetrating this doctrine, that is the generation has come, become like a tangled ball of string, covered as with a blight, tangled with coarse grass, unable to pass beyond states of woe, the ill destiny, ruin, and round of rebirth and death. If Ananda, if you are asked about aging and death, a condition for its existence, you should answer yes. If you answered what conditions aging and death, you should answer aging and death is conditioned by birth. What is birth conditioned by? Birth is conditioned by habitual tendency. What is clinging conditioned by? Clinging is conditioned by craving. What is craving conditioned by? Craving is conditioned by feeling. What is feeling conditioned by? Feeling is conditioned by contact. What is contact conditioned by? Now this is where there's only 9 links that he talks about. This is because of direct experience. Some of the links, like the 6 sense doors, sometimes people see them, most people do not. So they will see nama-rupa instead of, or mentality, materiality, instead of the 6 sense doors. And this is the way Ananda saw it. Mentality, materiality conditions contact, Venerable Sir. Consciousness conditions mentality and materiality. If asked, has consciousness a condition for existence? You should answer yes. If asked, what conditions consciousness? You should answer. mentality and materiality conditions consciousness. So he lets out, he doesn't talk about the six sense doors, he doesn't talk about formations, and he doesn't talk about ignorance. Now, why doesn't he talk about these things? Sometimes when people attain Nibbana, they don't see those. But they still see the links, and they still attain Nibbana and feel immediate relief. And this relief has a lot of happiness in it. And that it will last for a few days, even up to a week. And you feel like you've gone through something different. You've gone through something that's really quite remarkable. And because everybody talks about Nibbana in such high and glowing terms, people will come to me and say, "Is that all it is?" Like they're disappointed. And I say, "Do you feel comfortable? Do you feel relief?" "Well, yeah, but it's got to be more than that." It's everybody pretty much has a wrong idea of what the experience of Nibbana is. It's not any parting of the clouds in the hallelujah chorus when you have the experience. It's this deep sense of relief, like you've let go of something that has been there and you didn't even know it was there. And when it's gone, then you recognize, "Oh yeah, this is better. This is real good." And you start understanding intuitively the importance of keeping your precepts and the importance of practicing your precepts and how it is a protection for you. So there are different ways of attaining Nibbana. And I don't talk about this very much. You can attain Nibbana through your own understanding just by listening to a Dhamma talk and deeply understanding what is being said. You can attain Nibbana that way. That's what happened to Sariputta. All he did was hear two sentences and all of a sudden he was a Sotapanna because his understanding was so deep that he really got it. And then he went and told Moggallana about that, and Moggallana was a little slow. He had to listen to four sentences before he became a Sotapanna. Now that's the first and second chief disciple. That's not everybody does it quite like that. But there is this same sense of relief. There is this same kind of soft, gentle happiness. Just happy to be alive. And how thankful you are that you're born into the human realm so that you can have this kind of experience. I have run across a few people, very few, that have attained Nibbana through really deeply understanding the Dhamma. It's not anything to do with thought, but it's the understanding that is so profound. It's very good. Most people that I teach, they go through the jhanas. And they experience insights all along the way. Insights into how this process works. How truly the feeling of anatta is there. It's quite amazing. So most people, they see the links of dependent origination. Some people, they think about dependent origination in all different ways. And they can attain Nibbana. But it's a rare person that's like that. Doesn't happen all that often. Nibbana can be experienced by anyone who can get into a jhana. And it can be experienced at any time. So I've run across a lot of monks, and they have this idea that there is no such a thing as Nibbana in this lifetime. And they say, well, why even try? But I'm here to say you can attain Nibbana in this lifetime. And it is quite possible. It all depends on you and your deep understanding of the links of dependent origination and how they work, how the process works, and your understanding of that process. So, the more you practice and deeply experience the process, the more you become convinced that Nibbana is possible in this lifetime. One of the things that stops people from attaining Nibbana is that little L word, longing. I've heard about Nibbana for the last 35 years. I want it now. Some of the students, they come up to me after they have this attainment and they'll say, you know why I attained that? Because I sat and I told myself, I don't care about Nibbana. I don't care whether it really is real or not. I just want to watch, see what happens. So they let go of their attachment. Now, after Sariputta joined the Sangha with the Buddha, he was practicing meditation a lot. And he was seeing all of the links of dependent origination and how they all worked, and he was really going deep into it, and he understood it pretty well. Now, when he was fanning the Buddha, he was listening to the Dhamma talk that the Buddha was giving to someone else. And Sariputta realized, oh, the Buddha isn't even attached to the Dhamma. And he saw that he was. So in his mind, he said, oh, well, it doesn't matter whether it arises or not. And right then, he became an arahat. So that's the kind of attitude. Now, there is something that's called chanda, which is a wholesome desire. And a wholesome desire is a desire that has no ego identification with it. a wholesome desire is pointing your mind in the direction of understanding how all of this works. But you can't be attached to it at all. You can't hold on to anything. I mean, the simile of the raft going across the water. So you can get to the other side, you can't pick the raft up and carry it with you. You have to let it go, see what happens next. And that's a very subtle hint in how to do that. Okay, thus Ananda, mentality, materiality conditions consciousness, and consciousness conditions mentality, materiality. Mentality, materiality conditions contact. Contact conditions feeling. Feeling conditions craving. Craving conditions clinging. I'll be darned. Thick paper. Clinging conditions habitual tendency. Habitual tendency conditions birth. Birth conditions aging and death. Sorrow, lamentation, pain, grief, and despair. Thus, this whole mass of suffering comes into existence. I have said birth conditions, aging, and death. And this is the way that it should be understood. If, Ananda, there were no birth at all, anywhere, of anybody or anything, of devas or deva states, and it goes through all of the different kinds of beings there are, the yakas, the ghosts, the humans, the quadrupeds, the birds, reptiles. If there were absolutely no birth at all, for all of these beings, then with the absence of all birth, the cessation of birth, could aging and death appear? No. Therefore, Ananda, just this is the root, the cause, the origin, the condition for aging and death, namely birth. I have said habitual tendency conditions birth. If there were absolutely no habitual tendency in the world of sense desires or of form or formless world, could birth appear? No. Therefore, this is just the condition of birth, namely habitual tendency. Now, I use habitual tendency because it's easier to understand. Some people use the word becoming, some people use the word of experience, but they're hard to understand what's being said. And when I was in Malaysia the last time, I came across Puniji, Venerable Puniji, and I asked him to give me a Dhamma talk on bhava. That's what you can say becoming, but I say habitual tendency. As he gave a talk for about an hour on habitual tendency, on what I call habitual tendency, he was using the word becoming. Every time he used the word becoming, I looked to see how habitual tendency worked in that, and it works very well for the whole talk. And after he gave the talk, he said, "Did that satisfy you?" I said, "Perfectly." Habitual tendency works in all of the different ways that you're using becoming. So that's why I use habitual tendency, because you do understand it more, more easily. Clinging conditions habitual tendency. If there were absolutely no clinging, sensuous clinging, clinging to views, to rites and rituals, to personality belief, could they appear? No. Craving conditions clinging. If there were absolutely no craving for sight, sound, smells, taste, touch, tangibles, and mind objects, could clinging appear? Now, this is a real important point. Because when you use the six R's, what are you doing? If you use the six R's, your mind is clear, your mind is bright, there is no thoughts there. So there is no clinging. And because there is no clinging, there's no habitual tendency. Because there's no habitual tendency, there's no birth. Because there's no birth, there's no aging and death, sorrow, lamentation, pain, or grief. So you get a chance to see again the importance of the relax step. It leads you directly to mundane nibbana and eventually supermundane nibbana. So, one of the other things that you have to understand is, because everything has a condition for the arising of the next link, there is a slight bit of craving there. It's hard to recognize, but as soon as you six R it, then your mind is clear. So, when you get, say, into neither perception nor non-perception, where you sit for a long period of time without any kind of disturbance, and there's no movement of mind's attention, and you might see some movement start to arise, and you six R right then, you'll be able to sit for a long period of time before there's any more. And then the next movement comes up, and it's about half as big as the last one. And as soon as you see that slight little tiny vibration, then 6R again. And this is how you let go of all these conditioned things. And when you let go of, some people can see the formations. I had one student that could see all three formations, little teeny tiny vibrations. Most people don't see it quite like that, but he was exceptional. When you let go of the formation, there are no more conditions that arise. What does that mean? You're in an unconditioned state. Welcome to Nibbana. So it's a real interesting phenomena, the tiny little subtle things that craving arises with. But when you see that tiny little movement of mind's attention and six R it, it's not there anymore. You've let go of that condition. So, the more you become familiar with the six R's and relaxing that craving, relax. The more you do that, the more it turns into a habitual tendency, and it will start to happen by itself. His mind sees it, it recognizes, relaxes right then. There's no effort on your part at all. It takes doing this quite a lot. But it can happen reasonably quickly. Craving conditions clinging. If there were absolutely no craving for sight, sound, smells, taste, touch, tangibles, mind objects, could their clinging appear? You see for yourself, no, absolutely not. Doesn't appear. Why? Because you've let go of that craving. You've let go of the cause of suffering. Feeling conditions craving. If there were absolutely no feeling, feeling born of eye contact, ear contact, nose contact, tongue contact, body contact, mind contact, in the absence of all feeling, with the cessation of feeling, could craving appear? Now, this is a tricky question. The big craving doesn't appear, but there's still a little tiny bit of craving that arises with each one of these links. So you have to continue on with your six R's. You have to continue on letting it be, relax. It doesn't matter what it is that arises. What matters is what you do with what arises. I have some students that they want to know everything. What is that? And they start thinking, and all of a sudden they're pulled away from their meditation. So you probably the biggest fetter, I want to call it a fetter, it's not really, but is curiosity. I want to know. I've had students that have practiced for 3 years and practiced hard, and they, every time they came to practice with me, I was thinking, well, they're going to do it this time. They're really going to do it. And they get caught by the curiosity, and I tell them over and over and over again, let it go. It doesn't matter what it is. Their curiosity was too strong, and they kept going. Finally, they came, and they had gotten tired of finding out. That's called disenchantment. And when your mind becomes disenchanted, then you see this stuff come up, and you go, it's all the same, doesn't matter. Doesn't matter whether it's a thought. Doesn't matter if it's a past lifetime. Doesn't matter. So he just six R. And then he became completely dispassionate. He had no passion for what anything was that arose. He just wanted to see this process. And as a result, he attained Nibbana. Sometimes we have such we have such curiosity, we want to find out why everything happens, and you have to go through that. You have to suffer enough with it that you're willing to change and let it go. That's what this is all about. Learning to let go of the suffering that we cause ourselves. Learning to relax into it. It doesn't really matter what it is. If it's a sight, if it's a memory, if it's a sound, it doesn't matter what it is. What matters is seeing how this process works and how to let go of this process. And it always comes to relax. Open up and it doesn't matter. This is the key. This is the kind of mind you want to be developing as much as you can. In the absence of all feeling, with the cessation of feeling, could craving appear? The big craving cannot. But there's still a little bit of craving in each one of the more subtle links. Therefore, Ananda, just this is the root, the cause, the origin, the condition for craving, namely feeling. And so, Ananda, feeling conditions craving. Craving conditions seeking, seeking conditions acquisition, acquisition conditions decision-making, decision-making conditions lustful desire. What is curiosity? It's a lustful desire. I want to know. Lustful desire conditions attachment. Attachment conditions appropriation. Grabbing onto it. Making it yours personally. Appropriation conditions avarice. Avarice conditions guarding of possessions. Because of guarding of possessions, there arises the taking up of the stick and the sword, quarrels and disputes, arguments, strife, abuse, lying, and other evil and unwholesome states. I have said all these evil, unskilled states arise because of guarding of possessions. For if there were absolutely no guarding of possessions, would there be taking up of a stick or sword? No. So what are we talking about here? We're talking how to be in perfect balance no matter what. See, when we start taking things personally, then I'm there and whatever else is there and we're fighting. We're taking up the sword. We're at war. Sometimes it's just within ourselves, sometimes it's with other people. But when you use your six R's, when you keep letting it be and relaxing, doesn't matter what happens in your daily life, you have more contentment, you have more balance in your mind. And with that, you let go of the fighting. You let go of the taking it personally and not liking it or liking it. See the importance of the six R's. This helps you to develop a mind that is content all the time. A mind that has balance in it. Even if somebody comes at you with a lot of anger, you can have a balanced mind. It doesn't matter. That's that person's problem. It's not yours. You can be happy. You can be content. You don't have to take what they're saying personally. You can radiate loving kindness to them. And it confuses people when you do that. One time I was in Hawaii, I was at the beach reading a book, and there was these teenage boys that came around, and one of them jumped over me and kicked me. So I got up. I said, "Don't do that. That's not nice." And all of a sudden, these teenage boys were in a circle around me. And I'm thinking, well, this is interesting. They are going to hurt me. But as I looked at them, I saw that they were really suffering. They were building themselves up with anger, and you could just see it coming. So I practiced some compassion. What is compassion? Seeing another person in pain, allowing them to have their own pain, but loving them without any conditions. So I started radiating loving kindness to them out of compassion, because I saw they were causing themselves a lot of upset. And after a few minutes, they just looked at me and they shook their head and walked away. Because I practiced loving kindness, I wasn't afraid. And that's what they were hoping for. If I got afraid, then they would pick up on that. And this happens with animals too, especially dogs. They really go after people that are afraid. And they just calm down. Well, you're not worth getting in trouble. You know, you're not worth beating up. But there was no fear in my mind. There was a potential for fear. But because I was focusing on loving kindness, there wasn't room for fear to be there. So it's a real interesting thing that when you see somebody that's in the last stages of their life and they're dying from cancer or some kind of other horrible disease and they have extreme pain, an awful lot of people, when they go in and see them, they start going, "Oh, I feel so sorry for you." And what's that really doing? Bringing up pity leads to fear, leads to your own mortality, your ideas of mortality. And that's a frightening thing. But when I would go and visit, and I did this almost every day in Malaysia, I mean, they really liked having me in the room, because their pain is theirs. And I would remind myself before I walked in, doesn't matter what they're feeling like, I can love them. So I go in and I start radiating loving kindness, don't say much. And before long, the feeling in the room starts changing from dislike of the pain, and they're starting to get balance. Now, if your mind is uplifted and somebody else's mind is really down in the dumps with fear, anxiety, dislike, whatever it happens to be, if you stay with your uplifted mind, their mind will come up to yours. And a lot of times, people would say, "It's just like fresh air came into the room when you walked in." Why? Because I wasn't buying all of the pain and anxiety. It's not mine. I can't make it go away. It's yours. But I can love you. So the more you radiate loving kindness, the less dissatisfaction, the less war that you get into. The real interesting thing with Buddhism, if you want to be successful, you have to be willing to change. You have to be willing to let go of your old way of thinking and old way of being. You have to try something new. And you have to be willing to work at that. What you think and ponder on, that's the inclination of your mind. Oh, this person is always that way. And every time I think of them, they're always like that. What are you doing with that person? You're putting them pigeonhole. You're not allowing them the space to change because of your thoughts. And they don't disappoint you. They act that way that you don't like. But if you're willing to change and try something new and use your six R's, you'll start to see things become easier. That's what the Buddhism is all about. That's what the Buddha taught. He taught us exactly how to have a successful life. He taught us how to have contentment in our life. Well, it's not going the way I want it. It's not what I like. Okay, so? When we had the tornado hit down below, she came and told me about it. We were in town at the time. And the first thing I did was laugh. Okay, so there's a tornado. So what? Well, we have all this stuff that's... yeah, okay. Isn't that right?
Yes. When we were standing at the gate...
yeah.
The teacher said to me, are you okay?
Yeah, it's a little bit of an inconvenience. But hating the inconvenience doesn't make the inconvenience any different. It keeps it a real pain. But you can have fun with things. Okay, you got to pick this up and put it over there. What are you doing? Oh, I'm working. Well, I used to be a contractor. And it'd be 95 or 100 degrees and the lumber truck would come. And I had to move the lumber from the front of the building to the back of the building. So I started picking the stuff up and putting it in back. And the driver said, boy, you're really working hard. And I was shocked. I didn't even know I was working. I was just moving it from here to over there. That was all. And I was just as happy doing that. I knew what to expect because I was working and it was hot. I was going to sweat. Okay, fine. No problem. But if you build it up in your mind that, oh, I really don't want to do this. It's so hot. I can't hardly move. I can't breathe. And you put your aversion into what you're doing, it's going to make it hard work. But if you have acceptance in your mind, you're not at war with yourself, you're not fighting yourself or anyone else around you, all you're doing is just this. I just pick up a piece of wood, put it on my shoulder, and start walking. That's all I was doing, was walking. I wasn't thinking about how hot it was and how much I didn't like doing it and how I wish I'd hired somebody else to do it for me. It was just something that needed to be done, so I did it. With a happy mind. Your expectations of the way other people are keeps them that way. You're not allowing them the space to change. So you change. I had somebody come up to me that was practicing meditation. They started complaining about their wife. Oh, she doesn't do this and she doesn't do that. And he said, what am I going to do about that? And he was a Chinese man. And he was used to being the king boss. And he really did want to find out an answer. So I gave him the answer and he didn't like it very much. I said, you change. You want her to be different? You be different and be the example. After a few days, he came back and he said, well, I did start changing a little bit. Now she's picking up after herself. She's doing things. Okay, you changed your ideas about her. See, that's how powerful our minds are. When we have an attachment of the way we want things to be, that's the fastest way to have dissatisfaction arise, because it's not going to happen the way you want it to happen. But when you have an uplifted mind and you use the six R's, then everything changes. Everything becomes a lot easier, peaceful, calm. And with that comes contentment. Now this is the whole point of learning about the dependent origination and how this stuff works. When you start seeing it in yourself, you also start seeing it in other people. And you can pretty much guess what they're going through by just observing how the process works. If you want it to be different, change yourself. You can't change anybody else. If you think and ponder about somebody else and how much you don't like them, the more you think and ponder on that dislike, the more they act in ways that cause you to be unhappy. And that unhappiness is because you aren't willing to change. It's simple. It's easy to understand once you see this process. This is how it works. It works very quickly sometimes. But as you start to go deeper into your meditation, you will start to see more and more some of your habits that are kind of annoying to you, and then you start 6R-ing those, and that starts changing things. So the more you can see how this really works, the less you are at war with yourself and the world around you. Okay, I'll start over again at this one. All these evil, unskilled states arise because of guarding of possessions. If there were absolutely no guarding of possessions, would there be any taking up of stick or sword or even angry words? No, venerable sir. Therefore, Ananda, guarding of possessions is the root, the cause, the condition of all these evil, unskillful states. I have said avarice conditions the guarding of possessions. Appropriation conditions avarice. Attachment conditions appropriation. Lustful desire conditions attachment. Decision making conditions lustful desire. Now this is the decision of I am that, this is my opinion, I'm right, you're wrong. Acquisition conditions decision making. Seeking conditions acquisition. I have said craving conditions singing. If there were no craving, would there be any seeking? Now, this is what this one man had practiced for 3 years. He had that desire. He had that craving to see what was going to happen. What was that? And he caused himself a lot of suffering instead of seeing it as an impersonal process. He was seeing it as, I want to know this craving, and he wasn't able to recognize the craving. Therefore, Ananda, craving is the root, the cause, the origination, the condition for all seeking. Thus, these two things become united in one by feeling. I have said contact conditions feeling. Therefore, contact is the root, the cause, the origination, the condition for feeling. Mentality and materiality conditions contact. By whatever properties, features, signs, or indications the mental factor is conceived of, would there, in the absence of all such properties, pertain to the mind factor, be manifest any grasping at the idea of the mental factor? No, venerable sir. For in the present, or in the absence of any such properties pertaining to body factor, would there be any craving and clinging at sensory reaction on the part of the mind factor? No. So, realizing that you can 6R any time, in any condition, and when you carry the 6Rs with you, you are meditating. Still need to sit, because you need the quiet time. And when you sit, sometimes your mind will be very active at the start of the sit. So you accept that, okay, it's now it's time to be active. And you use your 6Rs and come back to your object of meditation after 15 or 20 minutes or half an hour. Sometimes it's a whole hour. All of a sudden, mind is still. Now your mind knows what you need. And your mind says, you know what? That mindfulness isn't as strong as it should be. So I'm going to throw up all of these thoughts and all of these opinions and all of these ideas and help this guy out so he can 6R all of these things and come back to his object of meditation. And then when the mindfulness is in balance, then the distractions stop. Now, this happened on the night that the Buddha became awakened. He got attacked by hindrances. Of course, they make up this story. They don't call it hindrances. Oh, Mara's daughters came. That's just a story. It was a hindrance. It was distractions. And it helped his mind to develop the kind of mindfulness he needed so he can go deeper into practice. So the hindrances are there to help you, and you have to remember they're not the enemy. They're not something to fight with. and hindrances can come up at any time during the day. It's true. So what do you do with it? Oh, I take it personally and get angry and throw a fit. Or not. How much pain do you cause yourself when you get angry? Because things don't happen the way you want them to. It's different than I had planned. Well, I'll tell you something about planning. You have to be fairly general with your planning. If you get real specific and it doesn't happen the way you want to, you get upset. Why? Because you take it personally. Because you're fighting with yourself. When the first time I went to Burma, they had all kinds of social unrest. And the Burmese army, well, it wasn't actually the Burmese army, it was the Kachin army that had all the guns, and they started shooting people. Well, I'm hearing these gunshots go off while I'm sitting in meditation. And they finally came in and said, you have to leave. Can't be here. You're a foreigner. We don't want you seeing this. We don't want you talking about this. Just don't do it. Go away. And they did it about a week before the end of the rains retreat, and Mahasi Center, they told them, let them finish the rains retreat. So it was about a week. We knew we were going to be leaving. So while I was sitting, I started thinking about this one monk, and he was a good monk, and we could do a project together. And I started planning the project. And I did it for a week. And I knew exactly what he was going to say, and what I was going to say, and how we were going to agree on this, and just do it. So I got time to leave. I got on the plane, went back to Thailand, Bangkok, where this monk was. Started looking for him and found out he'd gotten married. He disrobed. I spent a whole week planning exactly how this was going to go, and it didn't have anything to do with reality. So doing and trying to plan these kind of things, it never happens the way you think it's going to. So what a waste of time. You can generally plan, well, I've got to do this today and this, generally. But you don't go into it and just get into your restless thinking, because that's what it was. Thinking. Boy, I really, and I went over it and over it. I had these repeat thoughts, I didn't even recognize it. So that kind of planning is a waste of time. You don't know what's going to happen next. The person that you wanted to talk to left the country. Wow. Oh well. By whatever properties the mind factor and the body factor are designated, in their absence, is there manifested any... I really don't like this translation very much. Grasping at an idea or a sensory reaction? No, Lord. By whatever properties, features, signs, or indications the mental factor is conceived of, in the absence of those, is there any contact to be found? So he's talking about when you six are mentality, materiality, does any contact arise? No. Why? Because you've let go of the condition for it to arise. Then Ananda, just this namely mentality and materiality, is the root, the cause, the origin, the condition for all contact. Boy, I can't get used to these thick pages. It doesn't feel right. I have said consciousness, conditions, mentality, materiality. If consciousness were not to come into the mother's womb, would mentality, materiality develop there? No. Or if consciousness, having entered the mother's womb, were to be deflected, would mentality, materiality come to birth in this life? No. And if consciousness of such a tender young being, boy or girl, were thus cut off, would mentality, materiality grow, develop, and mature? No. Therefore, Ananda, just this, namely consciousness, is the root, the cause, the origination, the condition for mentality, materiality to arise. Now, when I'm teaching about dependent origination and how to look at it, then seeing it as a disturbance, each one of the links of dependent origination is a kind of disturbance to a peaceful, calm mind that has no conditions in it. When I talk about consciousness, and you say, let's say contact, in order for there to be eye contact, there has to be a good working eye, color and form. Eye consciousness arises. Where'd that consciousness come from? It was the potential of the nama rupa and the eye and color and form that made that consciousness arise. So the consciousness is a potential for this process. And the formations are the same thing. It's the potential for the formations to arise. What are the formations? Body consciousness, speech, and mind. Those are the potential to have all of these other things arise. And that body, speech, and mind is the potential for the consciousness to arise. The consciousness is a potential for mentality, materiality to arise. Mentality, materiality is a potential for contact to arise, and so on. Okay? When you let go of that potential, then the other links behind that do not arise. And that's eventually how you get into an unconditioned state. That unconditioned state is the supramundane nibbana. Every time you let go of craving and you use the six R's, you are experiencing a mundane kind of nibbana. Ni-no-bana, fire. So when you let go of that craving, you're letting go of the heat. And you have to do that often, to develop the habit of having it come up. the 6 hours, use the 6 hours more and more and more and more and more. Now, it's an interesting phenomena that, because I've done so much meditation, I'm able to recognize very subtle little things. And when I recognize it and saw it in myself, I can see that in students too. Because I did it so much that I became familiar with it. So I could recognize it real easy. When you don't use the 6 R's enough, the concentration will become very deep. But it's out of balance with your mindfulness. One of the big complaints of people that are practicing absorption concentration is noise. Any kind of a noise that happens, it boinks them because their concentration is too deep, their mindfulness is not in balance with it. We went to New Mexico and it was hot. It was like 95 or 100 degrees and they had no air conditioning in the meditation hall. So I turned the fan on. You should have heard people complain about the fan. It makes too much noise. It disturbs my meditation. It's only a sound. Why would it bother you? If your mindfulness is in balance, there is no problem. And when I was in Burma, my mindfulness would get out of balance with my concentration, and someone would come up and they'd say, "Bhante, Sayadaw wants to talk to you." And as soon as they said Bhante, it was like, whoa! Now, what is that actually saying? I was practicing one-pointed concentration at the time. So it was natural that the sound would cause that kind of reaction. It boinks you. But when I started learning more and more about the relaxed step, that didn't happen anymore. You know, a sound comes in, okay, there's a sound. No problem. There's ants crawling on me. Okay, there's ants. So what? No problem. It was really funny one time. I was sitting and I kept on thinking, There must be a lot of ants crawling on me because I'm feeling them all the way up my arm and they're wandering around doing this and that. And I thought, well, my curiosity is such that I have to look down and see whether it's just my imagination or it's real. And I looked down and there were ants that were starting to make a house for themselves in my arm, in my hand. They were bringing the eggs. Yeah. Long sitting, and I didn't move. I just didn't move. Yeah. So that's when I learned about this Chinese technique. Really good. They have this chalk that has insect repellent in it. So if I put it around me, they wouldn't cross the line. They would come right up to it, and turn around and walk away. But what they did was they would walk away and go up the wall, and then go up the ceiling, and they would start dive bombing. And I'm sitting very quietly and all of a sudden I feel this little body walking around on my shoulder. Wow, they're hard, it's tough. It was a real interesting thing, but when you're practicing one-pointed concentration and your concentration is deep enough, you won't feel anything. Mine wasn't, thankfully. I get up in an hour and I have a whole colony walking around on me. That wouldn't be so good. But it was an interesting phenomena. So when you feel a boink because there's a sound outside, a dog barks, or somebody kicks a trash can and it clangs real hard, if your mindfulness is good, that sound will go right through you. You'll hear it, you'll know it's there, but it doesn't cause any disturbance at all. That's what equanimity is all about. Yeah, the sound is there, yeah, I heard it, but it's just the sound going through. That's it. So, with any kind of disturbance, if it boinks you, that is the sign to understand that you are not using the 6 hours enough. You have to relax more. Now, when people are practicing one-pointed concentration, they get a major headache. I mean, really, really big. So much so that a lot of people that are practicing that kind of practice, they just said, I don't want to meditate anymore. It hurts too much. That does not happen when you're practicing with the relaxed step. Why does that tension arise? Because you're letting go of the distraction and you're bringing that craving back into your mind. You're bringing that tightness and it keeps getting tighter and tighter and tighter until, oh boy, it's major pain. That does not happen when you're doing this with your mind. When you're relaxing. Even when you get into realms of the arupa jhanas, the immaterial jhanas, you still hear things. You still feel things. Now, one of the differences between the absorption jhana and the tranquility jhana is that when you get in the absorption jhana, you don't feel anything, you don't hear anything, your mind is just stuck on one thing. That's it. When you're practicing the tranquility jhana, which is what I teach, you're doing this with your mind and your awareness. You're becoming aware of everything around you, but your equanimity is so strong that it's not a disturbance. It's just something that's there. Fine. Now, I know some people that teach one-pointed concentration, absorption concentration, they will tell you that when you get to the fourth jhana, you're not breathing anymore. You wind up having breath come through your ears, through your skin, things like that. But that doesn't happen when you're practicing tranquility meditation. Even when you get into realms of nothingness, you're still breathing. You don't breathe as fast, but you're still taking in oxygen in your lungs. So that's one of the signs that they look for with people that are practicing absorption concentration. Did your breath stop? Now I know where you are. Like that. And yes, I've practiced that. I do understand one-pointed absorption concentration. It's very blissful. It's very peaceful. It is quiet. But your mind is just stuck on one thing, to the exclusion of everything else. And that's why the headache is there for a period of time. Eventually, you stop paying attention to it, and the pain will go away. But there are other things that happen when you practice absorption concentration. You can have tinnitus. You have ringing in your ear. You can lose your balance very easily. When I first went to Asia, I went to this meditation center, and the way this monk, he was a Thai monk that was teaching people how to do meditation, and they were falling over backwards. And I'm going, what is that? Well, don't sit on any step because you can fall down and hurt yourself. Wait, that's that. What's wrong with that meditation? Oh, it's just the stage that you go through. Okay, I'll see you later. I want to go to somebody that knows a little bit more about the meditation than that person did. But there are strange things that can happen when you get one-pointed. It can cause problems physically. But what happens when you practice a tranquility is you don't have ringing in the ears. You don't have a loss of balance. You don't have these other weird little things that can happen with one-pointed concentration. Now, some people practice one-pointed concentration so deeply and so hard that they lose a sense of all reality. They're just stuck in their head. And they go crazy for a while. That was one of the beauties of going to Joshua Tree, because the teachers that were teaching them, they couldn't handle this person, so they sent them to Ruth. They sent them to Ruth Dennison. And she had gone through an experience like that, and she said, you're so much in your head, you don't even know you have a body. Now I want you to dig in the dirt. And I want you to take these rocks and put one on top of the other. Make these little, whatever they call them. Karen. Okay, Karens. And they'd come to her and they'd say, but I want to read something. No, you can't read. And she was pretty tough on them. You got to go do this, do that, do that. And eventually they got back into their body and they got some balance. But that whole thing was caused because of mindfulness was not in balance with the concentration. The concentration took over. And then they lost all sense of reality because they were so much into their mind. Never happens when we're practicing the way the Buddha talks. It never happens. Excuse me. Okay. Thus far, then, Ananda, we can trace birth and decay and death, falling into other states and being reborn. Thus far extends the way of designation of concepts. An interesting thing about getting into an unconditioned state, another way you can talk about it, is you're in a condition of no concepts. Every thought that you have is a concept. What is a concept? Well, this is a chair. Where is the chair? Is it the arms? Is it the legs? Is it the seat? Is it the back? It's a lot of little things put together to make up this idea, this concept of a chair. Oh, I've got to go to my car. Where's the car? Is it the wheels? Is it the windscreen? Is it the bumper? Is it the motor? Is it the steering wheel? Well, it's all of these things put together to make up this concept. And we think every thought is part of a concept. It's made up of a lot of different little things. This is why using the spoken word is so tricky. Trying to describe how... I can't describe this experience to you because it's all concepts, and you have to go through the experience to see. Then you try to explain it. Because the words I use, sometimes they might be right on, sometimes they're a long ways off. You got to figure it out. This is why you do the practice before you do the study. Because when you have the direct experience, you start looking at these words and you start going, oh yeah, I know what that's talking about. Why? Because you have the experience. It's very easy to read the suttas, but try to convince some people, oh, there's so much repetition. It's so hard to understand what they're talking about. It's not when you have the practice first. I told Kema when she started practicing with me, I don't want you to read anything for a year. Not a magazine, not a newspaper. I don't want you to read anything. After a year, I started giving her little booklets because her meditation had grown enough that she started to understand what these things, these concepts were that they were trying to get across because she had direct experience. She could understand it. And after another year or so, I gave her bigger books. And then she'd come and ask me a question, and at first I gave her the answers, then I asked her what the answer was. You tell me. And that gave her confidence, and then she told me right straight off, I can't memorize anything. I've had a stroke. I just cannot memorize. Guess what? Guess what she can do now? She's memorized a lot of stuff. She was willing to change. She saw the suffering she was causing herself and she didn't want it anymore. So you see things, you see ways that you act, and you don't like yourself when you act that way, then change. If other people don't like the way you act, then you change. What's the easiest way to change? Smile. Laugh. Have fun. Don't be serious. When you're serious, guess who has attachments that are causing themselves suffering? Guess who's caught up in these concepts as being real? Now, there's a book that I am very much impressed with that's called Concept and Reality. It's a deep book. It was written by Mahanidāna. He was a monk in Sri Lanka. He's still alive. He's about 82 or 83 years old. He wrote this thesis for his PhD. And there was two other monks that wrote a thesis at the same time on the concept and reality. And so he didn't submit it. He wrote on something else, and he went to island hermitage in Sri Lanka, and that's where Yanapanika was staying. And he showed this rough draft of concept and reality, and Yanapanika was so impressed with this, he said, I want to print this for you. And it's kind of turned into a Bible for monks that are serious about learning the in-depth difference between concepts and reality. I've only read it 10 or 12 times. And I highly recommend it. You can get a copy of it on the internet. I went to him when I was in Sri Lanka and I asked him permission if I could please print that book up for free distribution, and he said no, which shocked me completely. And he said, you're the second monk that's asked me about that. He said, there's this place in America called Dhammasukha Meditation Center that has ordered 200 copies of this book, and I don't have them. I have to wait till we get them printed up before I can send them to him. And I said, that's me. That's my center. Maybe he'll send them to us, maybe he won't. I don't know. He won't use a computer, so it's very difficult to stay in contact with him. He doesn't like the telephone. The only way you can really get in contact with him is to go to where he is. And you have to climb up a lot of stairs. Anyway. Another definition of Nibbana is the realm of no concepts. No opinions, no ideas. It's the unconditioned state. And I've been around monks that they spent a long time trying to describe it. It's impossible. Well, it's kind of like this, it's kind of like that. Oh, these are all concepts. You can't talk about something that has no conditions in it, because the only thing we know how to use is conditioned words. You have to experience it. Tell me what that experience is. Difficult. I've had people come and say, I know I have this experience, but I can't tell you what it is. Yeah, that's right. No problem. So, Ananda, we can trace birth and decay and death and falling into other states of and being reborn. Thus far extends the way of designation of concepts. Thus far is the sphere of understanding. Thus far the round goes, as far as can be discerned in this life, namely mentality and materiality together with consciousness. In what ways, Ananda, do people explain the nature of self? Some declare the self to be material and limited, saying myself is material and limited. Some declare it to be material and unlimited. Some declare it to be immaterial and limited. Some declare it to be immaterial and unlimited, saying myself is immaterial and unlimited. Whoever declares the self to be material and limited considers it to be either now or in the next world thinking, though it is not so now I shall acquire it there. That being so, all that is all we need to say about the view is the self is material and limited, and the same applies for the other theories. So much, Ananda, for those who pre-offer an explanation of the self. How is it with those who do not explain the nature of self? And they go into negation. It's a repeat of material and limited, and how it negates it, how it negates the self. In what ways, Ananda, do people regard the self? They equate it to the self with feeling. Feeling is myself. Feeling is not myself. Myself is impercipient. Or feeling is not myself, but myself is not impercipient. It is of a nature to feel. Now, Ananda, one who says feeling is myself should be told there are three kinds of feeling, friend: pleasant feeling, painful feeling, and neutral feeling. Which of these three do you consider to be yourself? When a pleasant feeling is felt, no painful or neutral feeling is felt, but only pleasant feeling. When a painful feeling is felt, no pleasant nor neutral feeling is felt, but only painful feeling. And when a neutral feeling is felt, no pleasant or painful feeling is felt, only a neutral feeling. Pleasant feeling is impermanent, conditioned, dependently arisen, bound to decay, to vanish, to fade away, to cease. And so too are painful feeling and neutral feeling. So anyone who, on experiencing a pleasant feeling, thinks, "This is myself," must at the cessation of that pleasant feeling think, "Myself is gone." Right? And the same with painful and neutral feeling. Thus, whoever thinks feeling is myself is contemplating something in this present life that is impermanent, a mixture of happiness and unhappiness, subject to arising and passing away. This is the influence of the Visuddhimagga again. Therefore, it is not fitting to maintain feeling is myself. But anyone who says feeling is not myself, myself is impercipient, should be asked, if, friend, no feeling at all were to be experienced, would there be the thought I am? To which he would reply, no. Therefore, it is not fitting to maintain feeling as not myself. Myself is impercipient. And anyone who says feeling is not myself, but myself is not impercipient, myself is the nature to feel, should be asked, well, friend, if all feelings absolutely and totally cease, could there be the thought, I am this? To which he would have to reply, no, Lord. Therefore, it is not fitting to maintain feeling is not myself, but myself is not impercipient. Myself is a nature to feel. From the time, Ananda, when a monk is no longer regards feeling as self or the self as being percipient, or as the being being percipient and a nature, and of a nature to feel, by not so regarding, he clings to nothing in the world. Not craving and clinging, he is not excited by anything. Not being excited, he gains personal liberation. He knows birth is finished. The holy life has been led. Done was what had to be done. There is nothing more here. And if anyone were to say to a monk whose mind was thus freed, the Tathagata exists after death, that would be seen by him as a wrong opinion and unfitting, and likewise the Tathagata does not exist, and both exist and doesn't exist. Neither exists nor does not exist after death. Why so far, Ananda? As designation and the range of designation reaches as far as language and the range of language reaches, as far as concepts and the range of concepts reaches, as far as understanding and the range of understanding reaches, as far as the cycle reaches and revolves, that monk is liberated from all that by super knowledge. Now, when you're talking about not self, why do you think I changed the word from not self to impersonal? Means basically the same thing. But when you see something in an impersonal nature, you're seeing that nature without any attachment to it, without any craving in it. You're just seeing it the way it is. That's what all the links of dependent origination and the importance of understanding this is all about. Being able to see everything that arises as part of a process. It's not my process. It's a process that happens for everybody. But there's nothing personal about it. So seeing it as an impersonal process, everything that arises, when you see that as it actually is, you become disenchanted with everything. There's no more excitement about anything. It's just, yeah, this is the way this is working. This process, yeah, that's it. It's not my process. It's something that happens because the conditions are right for it to arise. And when you see that as impersonal, you lose the want to grab it. You lose the want to change it. You lose the want to make it different than it is. It's just what it is. And it is okay. It has to be okay because that's the truth. It is what it is. There's no me in there. I certainly didn't ask this stuff to come up. I can't make it go away. All I can do is observe how that process works. And there's true liberation in being able to see that all of this stuff that happens doesn't have anything to do with me personally. It's all part of a process. I like that word, process. That's the way this whole mass of suffering arises, and with the realization that every different aspect of that arising is impersonal, that's how it ceases. How about that? as far as understanding and the range of understanding reaches, as far as the cycle reaches and revolves, that monk is liberated from all that by super knowledge. And to maintain that such a liberated monk does not know and see would be wrong view and incorrect. Ananda, there are seven stations of consciousness, two realms. Which are the seven? There are these beings, different in body and different in perception, such as human beings, some devas and some in states of woe. That is the first station of consciousness. There are beings different in body and alike in perception, such as the devas of Brahma, Brahma's retinue, born there on account of having attained the first jhana. That is the second station. Now again, you have to understand that the word jhana has a different meaning than what most other people think of jhana. The first stage of your meditation is the first jhana. That's the first stage of your understanding of how this process really does work. There are beings alike in body and different in perception, such as the Abhasara Devas, that is the third station. There are beings alike in body and alike in perception, and those are the Subakina Devas, that is the fourth station. There are beings who have completely transcended all perception of matter, and by the vanishing of the perception of sense reactions and non-attention to the perception of variety, namely, space is infinite, they have attained to the sphere of infinite space. That is the fifth station. There are beings who, by transcending the sphere of infinite space, thinking, conscious, not thinking, that's a bad word in there, consciousness is infinite, have attained the sphere of infinite consciousness, that is the sixth station. There are beings who have transcended the sphere of infinite consciousness, thinking, there is no thing. Having attained the sphere of nothingness, that is the seventh station of consciousness. The two realms are the realm of unconscious beings, and secondly, the realm of neither perception nor non-perception. Now, the unconscious beings, oh, we don't have the chart in here, do we? They are people that experience the fourth jhana. If they die and don't attain Nibbana, they will be reborn in this realm, and they will have a body, but there's no consciousness. It's like walking into a museum where there's just statues. It lasts for 500 mahakapas. And a lot of people, especially in this country, they have this idea that that's a horrible thing. But what relief, not having any disturbance at all. You're still alive, you still have a body, it does what it does. But you don't have any activity in your mind. Definitely. Why do I say they're like being a statue? Their body is still alive. They don't have any consciousness arising. No, it's deeper than that. It's more like being in the cessation of perception, feeling, and consciousness. It's just, Yeah. Well, they still have some, but it's not as we would recognize it. Right. So there is still some, but when you get to this realm, you have a body, that's it. And I've always envisioned that these people were there and their body was just standing there and there was somebody coming around dusting their body.
And
Mahakapas? What relief not having any kind of disturbance in your no consciousness. It is definitely a Brahmaloka that is worth experiencing.
Could that be coming from a one-pointed fourth jhana?
Both of the kinds of jhana have the same a similar kind of experience. Because you think back and the Buddha when he was born, Siddhartha, this monk came along and he said, oh, he's gonna be a Buddha, a future Buddha, and he started crying because he was going to be reborn in the Arupa Jhanas and he wasn't going to be able to hear what the Buddha said. And he was experiencing one point of concentration.
Yeah.
Well, there is craving in that state. That's why they come back. Now, Ananda, as regards to the first station of consciousness, and with a difference of body and difference of perception as the case of the human being, so and so on, if anyone were to understand its origin, its cessation, its attraction, its peril, and the deliverance from it, would it be fitting for him to take pleasure in it? No, Venerable Sir. You see how much pain is caused by that. Because you have pain for a little while, you have pleasure for a little while. Getting attached to either part causes to keep coming around. And as regards of the other stations, the two spheres likewise. Now these spheres, this neither perception nor non-perception, that's when you get into what I call the exquisite quietness of mind. Your mind is very clear, your mind is very bright, but you are alert. But you'll be able to sit for a long period of time when you get into that state, without having any disturbance at all. And then why it's called neither perception or non-perception is it's so subtle that you have to have that be quiet for a period of time before you can see any kind of vibration at all. And when you see that, now you're seeing the individual links, and you six are that, and then the next time you sit for another hour or so, and the next time you see a vibration, it's like half as big as the one before it. And because your mind is so still, you can six-R that. And that's how you're letting go of all of the links of dependent origination. I've had this student that for 3 years, she'd sit in that state for an hour, get up and start doing stuff. Nothing's happening. I scolded her up one side and down the other, and she still wouldn't get up. Finally, I told her, hey, your mind is exceptionally pure. Why do you want to break that and start cluttering your mind up with other stuff? And she finally got it. And she was successful after that. But it took me a long time to find the words that would impress her so that she would do it. Words are tricky things. Ananda, insofar as a monk having known as they really are the seven stations of consciousness and these two spheres, their origination and cessation, their attraction and peril, it's freed without attachment. That monk, Ananda, is called one who is liberated by wisdom. There are, Ananda, these eight liberations. What are they? Possessing form, one sees form. That is the first liberation. Not perceiving material forms in oneself. One sees them outside. In other words, you have a good working eye, that's the inside. It hits color and form, that's the outside. But seeing that as part of not self is what it's talking about. Thinking it is beautiful, one becomes intent on it. This is talking about getting into the fourth jhana. That is the third. By completely transcending all perception of matter, by the vanishing and perception of all gross sensory impact. Thinking space is infinite, he enters upon and abides in the base of infinite space. Now this is influenced by the Visuddhimagga and one-pointed concentration. And I had actually a fairly long talk with Bhikkhu Bodhi about this. I said, you're misinterpreting. You're causing a problem and you're misguiding people by not putting in gross sensory impact, because you still have some sensory impact if there is contact. It's not big, it's not disturbing, but you still feel it. And he wouldn't agree with me. He said, no, the Pali says this. And I said, I don't care what the Pali says. I'm talking from direct experience that this is what you really do experience. And you're misdirecting people so that they will go into one-pointed concentration rather than letting go of the craving. We had a lot of discussions at that time. No, infinite space. That is the fourth. By transcending the sphere of infinite space, thinking consciousness is infinite. One enters upon and abides in the sphere of infinite consciousness. That is the fifth. By transcending the sphere of infinite consciousness, thinking there is nothing. One enters upon and abides in the sphere of nothingness. I don't like the word thinking in this because it doesn't have anything to do with thinking. It doesn't have to do with contemplating. It has to do with experiencing. That is the sixth. By transcending the sphere of nothingness, one reaches and abides in the sphere of neither perception nor non-perception. That is the seventh. By transcending the sphere of neither perception nor non-perception, one enters and abides in the cessation of perception, feeling, and consciousness. That is the eighth liberation. Ananda, when a monk attains those eight liberations in order, forward order and reverse order, and in forward and reverse order, entering them and emerging from them as and when and for as long as he wishes, and has gained by his super knowledge here and now both the destruction of the corruptions and the uncorrupted liberation of heart and liberation by wisdom. That monk is called both ways liberated. Now what he's talking about is the mastery. Yeah. See, that's the whole point with being able to go into this jhana for this length of time. And when you make the determination to come out, you come out at exactly when you have that determination. It takes practice and it's hard work. But yeah, and you can do that, and then you can go from the first jhana to the fifth jhana to the third jhana to the second jhana and be in there for whatever your determination is. See, when I teach you the determinations, I get you to go to an hour, and then when you come out at an hour, I want you to go in and out of that jhana in 3 seconds or 5 seconds. So you have the skill to be go in and out whenever you want. And then you're walking down the street and you see somebody is arguing with somebody else, you can go in and out of the loving kindness and the fourth jhana and radiate that to them for the time that you're walking by them. That helps everyone, everything. Having that skill is a very, very useful thing. And as I understand it, the Buddha could go in and out of any jhana that he wanted to in between the words he was speaking. Now that, think about that. What power you have with your speech when you're able to go in and out of the jhana. I mean, you just heard me say in and out, and I can go in and out of a jhana twice in that period of time. That's pretty amazing. And the Buddha could do that. And Ananda, there's no other way of both of liberation. There's no other way of both ways liberation that is more excellent and more perfect than this. Thus, that's what the Buddha said. The Venerable Ananda rejoiced and delighted in the Buddha's work. Okay, let's share some merit. May suffering ones be suffering free, and the fear-struck fearless be. May the grieving shed all grief, and may all beings find relief. May all beings share this merit that we've thus acquired for the acquisition of all kinds of happiness. May beings inhabiting space and earth, Devas and Nagas of mighty power, share this merit of ours. May they long protect the Buddha's dispensation. Sadhu, sadhu, sadhu.